Lord, we're here today because of your wonderful grace. We're here today because of your mercy, because of your love. God, we thank you so much for Jesus. Lord, for the example that he was for us, and Lord, for the salvation that he freely offers all those who will trust in him. God, we thank you for the 100 years of grace and goodness that you bestowed upon New Home Baptist Church. God, you have been so good to us. God, help us as we continue, Lord, as we continue to pursue you, continue to spread your gospel. Lord, we thank you for all that you've done. Father, we pray for our services today, that you would be magnified by all that is said and done. That you would speak through Brother Brian Sellers, the words you have us to hear. And Lord, that true worship would take place this morning. God, we thank you. Give us time over to your keeping. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Good morning. Welcome to New Home Baptist Church. We are so glad you decided to come and worship with us today. We're especially glad to have your first-time guests. If this is your first time here at New Home, or maybe if you're here just to be able to celebrate our 100th homecoming, we are so grateful for your attendance today. No real announcements, but just to praise God again for being able to have this event. We thank God for the gym that is provided for us, and we look forward to worship this morning.
Please join me again for thanking God the Lord.
Great is thy faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, saith my soul. soul. Therefore, will my hope in him. 100 years ago, over in Coosa County, there was a small church that sat up on top of a hill above the banks of Hatchet Creek. The members were simple farmers who loved the Lord and were completely satisfied with where God had placed them in life. They had absolutely no desire to leave where they were at, but yet they had no idea that God was about to turn their world upside down. What turned their world upside down was progress. The Alabama Power Company decided that they were going to put in a new hydroelectric dam that would be what we now know of as Mitchell Dam, and they bought up 6,000 acres of land. Because of the land they bought up, the families had to relocate. Some of them came here to Elmore County, and on October 3rd, 1920, they started a new church on the banks of Callaway Creek. At first, the name of the church was the Baptist Church of Christ at Fitzpatrick. What a name. That was what they called themselves. Informally, that's what the name was in the minutes. About a year later, on December 31st, 1921, the church realized that they needed a new name. So as they began praying about it and talking about it, they came to the conclusion that, you know what, all of us are transplants. None of us are from around here. So I know what the name New Home usually means. It usually means that there was a church split somewhere, and some church was formed, and this is our new home, but that's not how the name came about. They realized that we are all new here, and this is our new home. And so they called the church New Home Missionary Baptist Church, and for 99 years, that has been the name of our church. Who were these people that God used to form New Home Baptist Church? Their names are this: Russell Isaiah Perkins, Alice Perkins, Maggie Perkins, Patty Perkins, May Perkins, Fred Perkins, Ida Perkins, John Varner, Emma Varner, Adolphus Varner, Alma Varner, J.C. Glenn, Ellie Glenn, Rennie Rains, Talika Rains, and the first pastor to serve us for 25 years, Brother Joseph Alfred Rains. These folks are the foundation from which New Home was built. They are the root from which we grow. And we want to read their names today to remember them, to honor them for being obedient to the Lord. We would not be here today had they not decided that when we move to a new location, we must worship the Lord.
Amen.
And so we're thankful for their faithfulness. Over the last 100 years, there have been 14 men who have served as our pastors. Joseph Rains, K.A. Hall, Sidney Gray, Owen Riley, Edgar Freeman, Jack Carnell, K.J. Bobo, Walter Roberts, T.J. Lambert, Thomas Stapleton, Hoyt Chastain, Walter Battisti, Dave Maddox. When I think about where we've come from and some of these names that have been read this morning, I think about Hebrews chapter number 11, that great hall of faith. Remember that by faith somebody did something, and the list goes on and on. But when you get down to verse number 32, the writer says this: "And what shall I say more? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon, and of Barak, and of Samson, and of Jephthah, and of David, and of Samuel, and of the prophets." We just don't have time, he says, to tell all of their stories, but just want to mention their names. And so this week, as I was pondering what to say, I began to think something like this: what shall I say more? The time would fail me to tell you of Perkins, and of Arnon, and of Glenn, and of Rains. The writer of Hebrews goes on to say, of whom the world was not worthy. And these all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise, God having provided some better thing for us, that they without us should not be made perfect. Wherefore, seeing we are also compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Perkins, Barnard, Glenn, and Graves have all run their race. They have provided for us a witness, a testimony of how to live the Christian life, but they're not here anymore. The wherefore that begins chapter 12 of Hebrews is now us. Seeing that we are compassed about with such a great cloud of witnesses, and there are new names over 100 years if we can list. But now that we must run our race.
Amen.
I do not know if the Lord will return in the next 100 years or not. It certainly seems so, but I can guarantee you that 100 years ago, they thought the Lord would come in their lifetime. If the Lord does not return in the next 100 years, will there be a new Home Baptist Church? Will people gather 100 years from now and remember 200 years of history? The only way the answer to that is yes, is if we run our race for the Lord. Not looking back, but looking unto Jesus. He is the one that we focus on. Today we gather to commemorate 100 years of service to the Lord here at New Hope. We do so with gratitude to the Lord, to the men and women who have gone on before us. We gather to remember the legacy. We also gather to recommit ourselves to our walk with God and to refocus on the future. 100 wonderful years, but the greatest days should be and can be in front of us. Listen again to Lamentations chapter 3. This I recall to my mind, therefore have I hope. It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, saith my soul. Therefore will I hope in him. For 100 years, the Lord has been faithful to New Hope.
Amen.
Souls have been saved, lives have been changed, and only eternity will reveal the impact that this church body has had for the Lord. Part of what we want to do today is look back for just a few moments to thank the Lord for his goodness. And one way that we are doing that is several months ago, I called Brother Scotty. They were just finishing the bicentennial in the state of Alabama. And I said, listen, I don't want to put anything more on you than what you already had. He planned the bicentennial celebration, basically, in the state of Alabama, from the History and Archives perspective. And I knew he was just worn out. And I said, nobody else knows about this. I haven't asked anybody. I haven't said anything to anybody. But would you write us a history book? And if you say no, nobody will be angry or mad at you, if nobody even knows. And he said, you know, Catherine and I have been praying about that. And we want to be able to do that for the church family. Just didn't know how to volunteer ourselves. And so for many months, they have worked on a book that will be distributed at the end of the service. Not now, but when I want your attention when he preaches. At the end of the service, every family will get a history book. But I'm going to ask for this Jacqueline, Brother Scott and Miss Jacqueline to come forward and just share a little bit about the book and whatever they would like to share with you about our history or process. But we certainly do appreciate them so much.
Amen.
Before I read this physical distance, and so I want to take just a moment to recognize them. Ms. Karen O'Mara, Doris Teddy Day, Mary Goody, Pam Ingram, Abel Nee, Bobby Joe and Shirley Swindle, Sue Martin, Brother Walter Matissic, Dale McCormick, Leanne Farr, Bobby Andrews, Linda Barentine, Steve Vickers, Kristen Goodwin, Chase Reynolds, Jason and Cindy Abair, Janice Ingram, Paul Leeds, Wendy White, Brother David Gillum, Brother Josh Simpson, Jane, Jerry Crow, Martin Sizemore, Jessica Smith, and Brother Eric Sutton. I want to encourage you to take advantage of the feelings that you're naturally going to have in the coming days. Big number anniversaries make us think. It's another reason why the state's bicentennial was so important to us, is because we were able to say, you're thinking now about what Alabama has been for 200 years. But the other part of that question is, what's it going to be in its next century? That's just as important for you as Christians and as members of this church. Today, August 4th, 2020, is the first day of this church's second century. Think about it. 200 years of serving the Lord starts today. The second century starts today. And it doesn't start with names of people that Eric read off. It starts with us. It starts with you. That's important. So I encourage you to take that next step. The reflections that this service will hopefully engender in you, I encourage you to take advantage of it and take that next step in New Home Second Century to record your own stories about what this Christian church has meant to you. In the back of the church history are two blank pages. This is not on accident. This is on purpose. These are for your stories. Think about your time in New Home, no matter how brief, and write them down. Write these stories down for yourself, for your children, for your church family. I can promise you, as a historian, this is important. What you write doesn't have to be long. It doesn't have to be poetic. It doesn't even have to be full sentences. But write down your memories. Write down what the Lord has done for you through this church. What our God Almighty has done in your life through this place that's been here now for 100 years. Coming generations will thank you and take heart and inspiration from your stories, just as we do today from the church's founders on this centennial. And Jacqueline and I have been blessed to assist with this special day because you're our church family, and we love you, and you have been so good to us in our 5 years here. Now, when you hold a book in your hand later, if you find any errors or problems with the text, that's my fault. But if you hold a book in your hand and you think to yourselves how beautiful it is, how wonderful the layout is, where do you thank Jacqueline? Because I've told her many times, next to the Lord, she's my second favorite designer. She does a beautiful job. Now, if you'll permit me, I want to read just a brief part from the church's history introduction. The history of a church is unlike that of other institutions. While common ground and shared experiences and creeds may unite the histories of nations, schools, or other entities, what binds the history of a church together across generations is something quite different. In his letter to the church at Corinth, the Apostle Paul wrote these words, "For as the body is one, and hath many members, and all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have all been made to drink into one Spirit." For 100 years, the members of New Home Missionary Baptist Church have been a small portion of the Lord's kingdom, through what Paul described as a local New Testament church with Christ as its head. From its beginning as a congregation of transplanted farmers, the members of New Home have earnestly continued in the Lord's work, ministering and witnessing to the small surrounding community of Central Alabama, and sending what resources it could into the broad mission field. As the church pauses to mark the centennial of its founding, its members make no grand claims of personal importance to religious history. To God belongs the glory, for the works written here and the many others unheralded. Rather than a simple recitation of names, congregants may feel the same connection that Paul described to the Corinthians. The history of the church should be no less. Thank you very much.
Before y'all go away, when I tell you that they have spent months and hours, late nights working on this project, I can tell you that I've gotten many emails at 12:01, 2:00 in the morning that say, here's the text for this section, can you check it out, let me know what you think. They have worked tirelessly on this project, and we just want to recognize in a very small way their support, their hard work, and I believe this gentleman likes yellow roses. And we've got a couple of things for, I asked Ms. Jacqueline about being a historian, was there anything, any book that was scholarly like? These Truths is a history of the United States. That's a big book, man. You need another 100 years. This is a small token of appreciation. Also, I'm sure there's somebody in the church that would be happy to babysit the kids so that y'all can go to have dinner together at our place cafe. In addition to that, the printer tried to upsell us on a color book. So Scotty went by to check it out, which didn't look good before, and they said, isn't that beautiful? Colored copy on the inside. And he said, that's beautiful. It's twice the price. We don't want it. But they let us keep the colored copy. And so this is the only colored copy that we have, and we want you guys to have it. Thank you so very much. We love and appreciate all that you've done. She met with Brother Scotty just a few weeks, came through a phone interview before she passed away, provided a lot of information. But there's not a member of this church who has not been touched by Sister Carrie Nath.
Amen.
And so the church voted a few weeks ago on Sunday night to dedicate the centennial book in her memory and her honor. And so I'm going to ask Brother John if he can come forward, Brother David, Ms. Hazel, and Brother Finley. Brother Finley is Ms. Carino's brother, Ms. Hazel is her sister, Brother David, her son, Brother John, her husband. We have a book for each of them, also a book for Brother Danny, her other son who's not here with us today. Sister Carrielle told the story many times. I wish I could have gotten all the facts right. She said that when the church opened up once a year for new members, and it was around the time of revival, and she was either the youngest or the first child that was baptized and joined the church. I can't remember how the story went, but she was so excited waiting for revival because she got to be baptized and joined the church. She spent a lifetime here, and I want to read to you the dedication page in the book. and you can pick these up at the end of the service. But it says, this is Carol Memorial, our worship at New Home Missionary Baptist Church, for nearly all of her 88 years on this earth. Her faithfulness to Jesus Christ manifests itself in countless ways, great and small, during her time as a teacher, encourager, prayer warrior, hostess, and pastor's wife. She selflessly offered her home to visiting ministers and missionaries from all over the world. Her loving heart and Christian example fed the souls and the stomachs of three generations of her church and community. Those who knew her said that she was precious, sweet, caring, a role model, compassionate, generous, and the finest Christian lady you would ever meet. Her infectious smile and warm hug would encourage even the loneliest heart. In the weeks before she was called to the just reward of her eternal home, Ms. Carol shared some of her experiences of growing up in the church and helped identify many of the photographs used herein. The Centennial History of New Home is dedicated to her memory. There's a quote from Charles Spurgeon which says, a good character is the best tombstone. Those who loved you and were helped by you will remember you when forget-me-nots have withered. Carve your name on hearts, not on marble. And Sister Carol certainly carved her name on our hearts. On behalf of the church family, we just want you to know that we love you, you're still in our prayers, and Ms. Carol had an impact on us, as all of you have, more than what we can tell you. And we pray that this book and her name in the book will be a precious reminder of the fine Christian lady that she is right now in the presence of our Lord. Amen. We love y'all. Thank y'all so very much.
Thank you. to the Lord comes and calls me away. Where the morning's so bright and the light is so high, and the
music and all the music this morning, it has certainly added to our service today. I was reading one of the history books that you will be getting after service this morning. And I was reading a little bit of that last night. And I noticed something that stood out to me, and I thought I'd share it with you, if you don't mind. I think it's on page 3. So look for this when you get your book on page 3. Back in the early years, I don't know if it was Miss Carradale or maybe some of the other people giving their memories there of the church. Back in the 20s, when they would have Saturday and Sunday services, they would have protracted meetings sometimes that would last a week or so. And, they'd open up the church house and turn on the old kerosene lamps for light. And that page now, page 3, said that the preacher would get up and preach for 2 hours. I thought, in celebration, centennial year, maybe we could just let you see what that feels like. If I said it, all God's people said, I know what I would get. Absolutely not. So, anyway, we won't be here that long. But my, what a rich history this church has. What a phenomenal job that it's done on that book. And I congratulate you as well. I want to speak to you this morning on the subject, 100-year legacy. 100-year legacy. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 21 is a verse of scripture that I'm sure most of us could even probably quote by heart. And it's one that is packed full of meaning, especially for our occasion today. The Apostle Paul, writing to the church at Ephesus, and he says these words. This is after a phenomenal prayer. He prays for them that he know that they would be filled with the knowledge of God. And one thing I enjoy about reading after the Apostle Paul and his ministry, no matter where Paul was, no matter what the subject was, no matter who he was writing to or the problems that he was dealing with, when he got done, he wanted people to understand and to know that it's all about Jesus.
Amen.
It's all about Jesus. And folks, it still is all about Jesus. This last 100 years has been all about Jesus, what he has done in and through the lives of New Hope Baptist Church. And this is what he says. He says, unto him, talking about God, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus, throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. Unto him be glory in the church. Apart from our salvation in the Lord Jesus, there are few things that are as meaningful and as important as being in fellowship with one of the Lord's New Testament churches. Folks, I'm telling you today, church membership is important. The Lord's New Testament church is crucial. He goes on in Ephesians chapter 5. You remember when he's talking to the husbands, and he says, husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. There are various ways of giving God honor and glory in our lives, but the greatest avenue and the greatest vessel that God receives honor in is in one of his New Testament churches. Unto him be glory. And that's what Christians are about, is giving honor and glory to the Lord. Our lives are to be, we are to glorify the Lord Jesus. What's the best way, the best vessel, the best avenue? Unto him be glory in the church. I think we ought to make a big deal about the church, because the church is a big deal with our God. The New Testament church is the only institution that has been bought and paid for by the precious blood of Jesus. Amen. I count it an honor. I don't know about you, but I count it an honor and a great privilege to be a part of the New Testament church.
Amen.
As you look over the last 100 years, I'm sure the challenges over the years have been many. Again, reading in that book last night, back in the 20s, and just prior to the Depression, there in the 30s, and people didn't have anything. There was no money. There was no currency. It was going around, and dark days were upon them. But yet they blessed. Preachers were fed with groceries and things of that nature. But they didn't go hungry. Why? Because God blessed. And I know over the years the challenges have been many. Maybe many times seem almost insurmountable. That's the way it is sometimes in churches. But friend, the faithfulness presence of God has always been present. His grace has always been sufficient. And I think the future success of New Home Baptist Church will be determined by how we continue to trust God and by fulfilling the great commission that He has entrusted to His churches. This church has enjoyed the blessings of God down through the years. Commitments have been made, lives have been changed, souls have been saved and added to this church. And today we honor what God has done in and through this church for 100 years. Now, here's the question. How do we continue to enjoy God's blessings, God's benefits, God's presence, and God's power in and through New Home Baptist Church from this day forward? Well, I believe that New Home can continue to experience the greatness of God in the future if the members of this church will resolve in their hearts to keep three crucial elements. They're crucial elements that we need to keep in our hearts in the forefront of our ministry. The question was asked earlier by your pastor, will there be a New Home Baptist Church 100 years from now? Well, only the Lord knows that. We don't know if He's going to return in those 100 years or not. But will there be a New Home Baptist Church in the next 100 years? Well, I'm telling you, there can and there will be if we'll keep these three elements forefront in our hearts and in our ministry today. I want to share these three elements with you this morning. Three things. Remember now our theme, that this goal here, unto Him be glory in the church. How can we give Him glory in and through the Lord's New Testament church? Let me give you three ways. Number one, we must hold to an unchanging message. We must hold to an unchanging message. You know, we live today in an ever-changing world, do we not? I mean, things change, people change, circumstances change, events change all around us and in our lives. But God's people must continue to hold to an unchanging message. That's what Paul wrote to the church at Corinth there in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. And Paul began that chapter by saying, and I, brethren, he said, when I came to you, he said, I came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom. And he's sharing unto them how he came to Corinth. He says, declaring unto you the testimony of God, for I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and Him crucified. You see, with Paul, it was all about Jesus. With Paul, it was all about the message of Jesus Christ. And that is the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. Christ is the central theme of our message today. The Corinthian church, as you know, was a church that was deeply divided over many issues. One issue was which former minister, pastor, had contributed the most to their church. You remember that discussion that Paul had with them? I believe what Brother Eric, you're the 14th pastor here. And I was thinking about that too. You know, some people, when Paul was writing to the church at Corinth, some would say, well, you know, Paul, with, you know, all Paul, he's our man. He can't do it, no one can do it. We're behind Paul. We support Paul. You know, he helped found this church. Others would say, well, you know, Paul's all right, but we're Apollos. I mean, he was a mighty, bold preacher. I like the way he preached. You know, I like the way he got the message across to the people. Others would say, well, we're a Cephas. We're a Peter. You know, we're Peter's man. And then those highly spiritual ones would say, we're of Christ. We're of Christ. Paul dealt with all of that in 1 Corinthians. But I'm telling you, friend, when he ends up by saying this, sound preaching has one great theme, and that is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ in Him crucified. He goes on to say there, Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel. And to continue in the Lord's power, in the Lord's glory, in the Lord's presence, and with the Lord's benefits and blessings upon our lives today, we must hold to an unchanging message. Jesus Christ in Him crucified.
Amen.
Do you realize it's by the death of Jesus Christ that we are cleansed from our sin? According to the Scriptures, 1 John 1:7 says, but if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin.
Right.
It's by the death of Jesus that we are cleansed from our sins. And so that's why Jesus and him crucified ought to be a paramount message here at this church. Why did God bless for 100 years? Do you realize there are many churches today that can't claim that, that will not be able to claim that? But let me give you one reason why God's blessing has been upon this church. Because this church for 100 years has held to an unchanging message. Jesus and him crucified. It's by the death of Christ that we're cleansed from our sin. It's also by the death of Jesus that we are accepted and reconciled to God and have peace with God. You and I today, listen, there is absolutely no possibility of mankind having peace with God apart from Jesus.
That's right.
And the price that was paid on the cross. Ephesians 1:6 says, to the praise and the glory of his grace, wherein he had made us, watch this, accepted in the beloved. We are accepted, not by my work, not by my merit, nothing else. All by the pure grace of God.
Amen.
Through the work of Jesus. It's by the death of Jesus we're cleansed. It's by the death of Jesus we're accepted and reconciled. It's by the death of Jesus that all men are drawn to Christ. Jesus himself said in John chapter 12, he said, if I be lifted up, will draw all men unto me. Friend, it's all about lifting up Jesus. We've sung about it this morning. To God be the glory. There's something about that name. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Let me tell you, New Home, if you're going to continue with God's blessings in your life and power, listen, by the way, that's what you want. That's what you want. Lift up high the name. Make much out of the name of Jesus. Christ is our central theme. Christ is our central theme. Also, the whole counsel of God is needed for growth. All of it. All of it is needed for growth. That's what Paul writes in Acts chapter 20 and verse 27. He says, for I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. You say, why is it so important that we open our Bibles and bring our Bibles and come together in the Word of God? Why? Because it's crucial that we look at all the counsel of God, not just part of it, not the parts that we like and pick and choose. Listen, friend, this is not a buffet. The Word of God is not a buffet. It's not something that we just go to, oh, I like this, and oh, I like this. No, all the counsel of God. All of it. He goes on to say, take heed, therefore, unto yourselves and to all the flock over which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers, to feed the church of God, which he had purchased with his own blood. That's the word. And we know what 2 Timothy 3:16 tells us. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine and reproof and correction and instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, truly furnished unto all good works. We need to make much of Jesus. We need to make much of the Word of God. I've been to services before where they never open a Bible. And I'm thinking, what are you doing? And they wonder why they have the issues that they're having. Many today are ignorant of the scriptures. And Paul says, listen, brother, I don't want you to be ignorant. He says, I preach to you the Word of God. He poured his life on the line, put his life on the line to preach the Word of God. We've got to make much of Jesus. We've got to make much of the whole counsel of God. It says all scripture is given by inspiration of God. Think about that. All scripture from Genesis to Revelation is God-breathed. Theopneustos is a Greek word. It means breathed out by God. It's all of it. And it's profitable. In other words, it's helpful. This book will help you if you let it. If you'll open it, if you'll read it, and if you'll obey it, you'll be amazed at how God will help you. It's profitable. It's useful in teaching. You say, well, what is it profitable for? Doctrine. In other words, what's right. It teaches you what to believe. What's right? What to believe. Also, for reproof, what's wrong? It tells us what's right, and it tells us what's wrong. Also, for correction, what does that mean? That means how to get right. How to get right. For instruction, hey, how to stay right. This book teaches you how to get right, how to stay right. Isn't that what you want for the next 100 years?
Amen.
He said, well, we're living in dark days. Can I tell you something? Yeah, they're dark, but they're gloriously dark. Think about it like that. They're gloriously dark. You see, the unchanging message is the old-time gospel. That's what it is. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 15, the first four verses, and he tells us what the gospel is. He says, moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel. And he goes on and talks about how it's the word of God, how Jesus lived and he died and he was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the scriptures. That's our message. That's our message. That is a message that has the power of God attached to it.
That's right.
And that's what we want. Well, we must hold to an unchanging message if we want to continue God's blessings. Do what we've done in the past and hold to an unchanging message. Secondly, not only must we hold to an unchanging message, but we must hold to an uncompromising stand. Hold to an uncompromising stand. I was reading over the book of Joshua this week, and I just love Joshua's farewell address to the nation of Israel. If you remember what Joshua says in Joshua 24:15, he told the nation, he said, it seemed evil to you to serve the Lord. He said that choose ye this day whom you will serve. And he goes on and he says, well, it be the God of your fathers, how they serve him on the other side of the flood, the God of the Amorites, in whose land you dwell. He said, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
Amen.
He was a man that took an uncompromising stand in his ministry that God gave him. Compromise. And you know, we live in a world today just full of compromise. You know, just let the walls down, the barriers down. And let's just, all, I heard a lady here, Rob asking, why don't we just drop all these doctrinal barriers and everybody just come together? Listen, that sounds pleasing, but that is heresy.
Yeah.
It's heresy. We must stand to an uncompromising or hold to an uncompromising stand. Compromise is the first step to disobedience.
Right.
You don't believe that? Read Genesis chapter 3. Compromise is the first step to disobedience, right? When the serpent tempted Eve there in the garden, Genesis 3, you know, did God really say that? Hath God said, you know, tempting her, and then we know what happened later, right? And the whole world was plunged in the sea. Of that event. Listen, compromise is the first step to disobedience. Listen, whenever Christians or churches compromise their godly principles, they walk dangerously close to a deadly landmine. That's fact. Avoid compromise. Avoid it. Make God's word your standard of conduct. That's what I'm trying to say. When you compromise doctrine, it becomes much easier to compromise on issues of morality and conduct. It starts with the Word of God. You see, compromise also limits our ability to do what's right. It really does. It limits our ability to do what's right. Compromise will weaken and destroy our faith. Compromise will limit future opportunities. Hold to an uncompromising state. I believe God's people ought to know what they believe and why they believe. I believe that with all our heart. It's not because mom and daddy said it or this is how I was raised. Hey, listen, that won't cut it. That won't cut it. We believe it because this is what the Bible says. This is what God says in His Word. Hold to an unchanging message. We must hold to an uncompromising statement. And then third and lastly, we must hold to an undeniable hope. An undeniable hope. I want you to turn with me this morning to 1 Thessalonians. Usually, most all my messages are expository, but this morning just didn't work out that way. But I want you to see something here in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 as we close this out this morning. We must hold to an undeniable hope. You say, Brother Brian, what is our hope? What is our hope? Well, I want you to notice in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, these are normally words that you would hear preached or read at a graveside or a funeral service, but I want you to, listen, this is not a funeral service today. I want you to get this. In verse 13, Paul writes, he says, but I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. He's not saying that there is not sorrow attached to death. What he is saying is that our sorrow, when we lose a loved one, is not like those who have no hope. It's different. He says, watch this in verse 14. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, let me stop there. Do you believe that Jesus died and rose again?
Amen.
All right. Then, hey, I want you to understand you've got a glorious future. Listen to this. He says, even so them also which in Jesus, that's the euphemism, sleeping. He's not talking about souls sleeping. He's talking about those who have passed away. It's a general word. It's a euphemism. Those, he says, which sleep in Jesus, watch this, will God bring with him. They're not left out. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord, watch this, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with the shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Shall, by the way, is a commandment. When God says, thou shalt, it's a commandment. And notice the four commandments. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven. Friend, listen. Jesus is coming to be.
Amen.
That's the promise of a return. That is our hope. Our hope is in Jesus. Our hope is in the Word of God. We must hold to an undeniable hope. It doesn't matter how bad it gets down here. It doesn't matter what kind of pandemic. We have to wade ourselves through. Jesus is coming again. There's a promise of a return. Secondly, in the last part of verse 16, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. So there's a promise of a return. Then there's a promise of a resurrection. The dead in Christ shall, commandment, shall rise first. Wow. Then in verse 17, he says, then we which are alive and remain shall be caught together. By the way, that's the promise of a rapture.
Mm-hmm.
That's the promise of a rapture. We that are alive and remain shall be caught up together. Watch this. With them, what a reunion. Mm-hmm. To meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. That's what we're talking about. Of a residence.
Amen.
So shall we ever be with the Lord.
Right.
You say, Brother Brian, what's heaven like? I don't know. But I'm going to tell you what, I think I'm going to be satisfied.
Amen.
Why? Because it's all about Jesus.
Yep.
And friend, listen, when I get there, no one's going to have to take me by the hand and say, come over here, let me show you Jesus. That ain't how it works. Listen, friend, heaven is about Jesus.
Amen.
There's going to be no need for the sun, the moon, the star. None of that. The Lamb.
Amen.
It's what a future. Regardless of what I have to go through down here. What a future. An undeniable hope. Don't tell me over the past 100 years, even the early years of the formation of New Home Baptist Church, that there weren't people that were struggling, had hard times like you and I don't even know anything about. And they had a hope. The Lord Jesus.
Yeah.
That hope continues even today. Folks, our hope is based on God's faithfulness. The second coming of Christ is going to signal victory for the child of God. That's why Paul writes 1 Corinthians 15:57, but thanks be unto God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. You see, the second coming will signal our new beginning. Our new beginning. I was reading over in Revelation 21 this morning, where he talks about, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, and the old, the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And he goes on, and he's just describing things about the new city of Jerusalem, you know, as a bride prepared for a husband, and all of that. Then he goes on and says, there's no more death. No more crying, no more pain. The former things are all past. What a day that we live.
Amen.
Folks, that's our future. That's our hope. That's our hope. My hope is not in Washington, D.C.
There you go.
My hope is in Jesus.
Amen.
That's what I want us to get today. It's all about Jesus. Today we celebrate God's faithfulness here at New Hope for 100 years, and there's a reason why he's blessed for 100 years. This church has held to an unchanging message. This church has held to an uncompromising stand. This church has held to an undeniable hope.
Amen.
And because of that, God has poured out his grace on this church. And friend, not only has this worked in the past, but it's crucial that we hold these messages from this day forward. From this day forward. I think the Bible says something about remove not the ancient landmarks. These are landmarks of our faith. May God help us not to remove them. Bless you, home church. What a great church this really is. I don't think I ever said that I won't become a new pastor, brother. But if something happens.
Amen.
God's good.
Amen.
All the time. Let's continue this day forward. Just continue to praise him. Hold that message. Hold that stand. Look to Jesus. And my friend, he'll bless you like never before. Let's pray. Father, we thank you today for all of your blessings in our life. We thank you today for just for what you've done in the 100 years. And on our side, that's such a long time. And on your side, that's not even a blip on your radar compared to eternity. Father, Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness. That's who we celebrate today, is you and what you've done. And I pray today that you'll continue to add to this church, bless this church, her pastor, every member, every visitor that comes. God, I just pray that you just pour out your blessings upon them. Revival would come. And Lord, people would drive for miles around to see what's going on here at the New Home Baptist Church. Father, thank you for your faithfulness in our lives. And I pray today that there be someone on this that doesn't know Jesus. Father, that today will be that day, the first day of the new century, someone give their life to Jesus. I pray today, Lord, that you bless this invitation this morning.